In this video lecture, we'd like to talk about the next data-related topic, which is that of literals. We can think of literals as being the hardwired data in our programs. Okay, let's get started. Literals are simply the numeric or textual symbols hardcoded into our programs and used to assign specific data into variables. As their name implies, their values are literally whatever they show. And as we said a moment ago, they represent the hardwired values in our code. What I'd like to do in these next few slides is go over each of the basic types of literals and look at a few examples of them. All of the examples we're going to take a look at may be found in the example file literalexamples.java, which you can download from the example source code module in Canvas. As will be the case in many of the examples we'll be looking at going forward, I encourage you to download these files to your own system and open them up in JGrasp so that you can follow along. The first broad class of literals are the various integer literals, which can be of any of the integer data types: int, short, byte, and long. Remember, in this class, we'll mostly be concerning ourselves with just the int and the long data types. The format of integer literals is pretty simple. They consist solely of the digits 0 to 9, and possibly the hex digits A through F in any combination. There might be a leading plus or negative sign, but what you won't see in an integer literal is any decimal points, because those are solely used by the floating point types. And of course, if we're trying to set a hex literal, we need to prefix it with a leading 0x. Here's the one gotcha with integer literals, and this is something that often throws students. If you want to express some number as being a long data type literal, you have to terminate it with the L symbol in either lower or uppercase form, with a capital L being preferred for readability. This is a reason why you might prefer to express routine integer literal values using the int data type exclusively, so that you don't have to deal with this little nuisance. So in these examples, we've got an int variable for absolute zero with a value -273, and here's that optional leading minus sign. Here's a literal for some population variable, and because it's of type long, the number we want to set it to must have this trailing L. And here's an integer literal for some opcode variable whose value is hex DE with a required leading 0x. Just as a review, each of these instructions is one Java statement with a required semicolon terminator. Also, each of these statements represents a variable declaration and initialization together, because we are specifying the variable name, its data type, and its value assignments all together in one statement. And again, all hard-coded values such as these in a program are literals. We'll look at these examples in code in a few moments. Next, here are the general guidelines for floating point literals. Remember that there are only two floating point data types, float and double. As before, numeric floating point literals can have a leading plus or minus sign, then the rest of the number consists solely of digits 0 to 9 in fixed or scientific format. What we won't see in these numbers, obviously, are any of the hex digits, because we don't express floating point numbers using hex. There's a similar little gotcha for floating point literals, and that is, to express a literal value as a float, you must terminate it with either an uppercase or lowercase f, similar to what we saw for the long data type. Again, for this reason, you might find it preferable to use the double data type exclusively for floating point data, to avoid this little nuisance. That might seem a little wasteful from a computer memory standpoint, and it probably is, but for the programs we'll be writing in this course, it's really not going to matter much. So here are a couple of examples. The first one is a literal value to initialize this sales tax rate, and because it's a float variable, we have to have this terminating F. This other one is a literal for the speed of light variable, and notice that this is how we express numbers in scientific notation with this E as the exponent. Once again, these statements represent declaration and initialization together, and notice that we have good Java variable names, which have initial lowercase, camel case naming, and they are both clear and descriptive names. Character literals represent single printable characters, represented in several possible ways. We can express chars as single characters inside a pair of single quotes, as we see here for the gender variable literal. We can express chars as a numerical value over the range decimal 0 to 65535, or the corresponding hex range 0 to hex FFFF, which of course is the 16-bit, 2-byte size defined by the char data type for the Unicode characters. So here in this example, here is how we might represent the tab character with its Unicode hex equivalent. Finally, we can also represent special escape sequences using this kind of backslash format, the most common examples being a new line, or a tab, or maybe also embedded quotes. We can also embed Unicode characters into any string text by using this backslash U format, as shown here. As we'll see in another example, these types of escape sequences can be inlined within strings to format them, and they are frequently used for this very purpose. Again, please take a look at these examples as shown in the literalexamples.java file. The next type of literals are those for Boolean variables, and these are quite easy because there are only two possible values for them, true or false. The only two values a Boolean variable will accept. In these example statements, notice that it's not necessary to have any single or double quotes around the literal true or false values. Those are just predefined Java reserved words. We can also express strings as literal values, but just by way of review, remember that strings are not primitive data types in Java, but rather are classes. So strictly speaking, realize that anything we might refer to as a string variable is truly a string object. A string literal is just any amount of text enclosed within double quotes. There are multiple ways to create these, and we'll be putting these to use extensively in our programs to display output. As we've already seen in our Hello programs, we can use the plus as a string concatenation operator to glue together larger strings out of smaller ones, as we see in this first example. We can also embed escape sequences into our string literals to do some specific formatting, as we see in this second example. Here we have a backslash n new line character in the midst of our string literal, so that when we print this string, it will be split up over two lines. We see this same kind of thing in this third example, where we have a couple of tab characters embedded into this string literal inside double quotes. What we also see in this example is the combination of printing some identifying string label together with the value of some variable. This is actually pretty important because we'll be doing this over and over again in our programs to output their results. Here we are printing out the numeric value of an age, but we are also accompanying that data with some kind of label, which we should always do in our program outputs. There should be an application note with more details on this in this week's Canvas module, which I want you to make sure to read. Here's a source code example of using Unicode characters in some formatted program output. This example can be found in the file unicode.java in Canvas, and I encourage you to download this file, open it in JGrasp, and follow along. But since this example is so short, I'll talk about it from this slide. So what we see here on the first lines is two different representations for the euro symbol in Unicode. I suppose first of all we should know the Unicode value for the euro symbol, which is hex 20AC. How did I get that, you might ask? You can simply Google it or just find some table of the Unicode symbols. This first one, euro 1, declares the symbol as a Unicode literal using the backslash U prefix before the Unicode value for the euro, all within single quotes. The second one, euro 2, simply uses the Unicode hex value directly. Together, these two examples tell us that a char variable can be represented as something within single quotes or as a straight numerical value in hex or even decimal. So what we're doing here is printing out the euro symbol in three different ways. The first two are using string concatenation, so for each one, we have some sort of labeling string followed by the value of the char variable itself. This is just a standard way of displaying some output. Some label for a variable, followed by the variable value itself. In this third example, all we're doing is printing out this one string literal, but embedded inside of it is the backslash u escape character, followed by the inline Unicode value for the euro symbol. And notice that in this case, just as for the other cases, we have some inline escape characters to print some tabs. The exact number of tabs needed in each case might take a little trial and error, but what we're after is for our output values to be nicely aligned, as shown here below. So when this program is compiled and run in JGRASP, you should see this output, which is the euro symbol printed in three different ways. So this example shows us different ways to handle Unicode characters in our program outputs. That ends this video lecture, and we'll continue on with the next topic.